Almost feel like I should have an alternative message. God said this is what I'm preaching, so this is what I'm preaching. But this morning, the Holy Spirit's just working. I'm excited at what He's done. We did turn to the book of Romans this morning, and you can refer to that a little bit if you want. We're not leaving the book of 1 Corinthians. We'll be in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, we'll be in Romans chapter 12, we'll be in Ephesians chapter 4, and we might even linger over into 1 Peter chapter 4. We're going to be kind of all over the place. But we have been talking about this important idea of spiritual gifts and how significant that is. And we've spent a number of weeks discussing the proper understanding of spiritual gifts, the foundation from where they come, the reason why they exist. And we'll begin soon to discuss more specific attitudes and actions related to the spiritual gifts and their practice. But eventually we need to do something that's just as important, and that is to discuss the specific gifts themselves. And so today we're going to start that. We're not going to complete it. We could spend months and years studying spiritual gifts, and depending on your thoughts and understandings of what gifts are and how many gifts there are and what kind of gifts are for today and all those other kinds of things that we tend to want to fight about, you can come up with all kinds of things, and we could be into that, but we're not going to do that. We're going to take the next, today and next week probably, hopefully we'll get through it next week, but we're going to spend this time discussing foundational gifts. And what I mean by foundational gifts is, no matter where you come down on the issue of spiritual gifts, when you look at the four passages of Scripture that I mentioned to you a few minutes ago, we can see very clearly outlined 19 different gifts that are there, that are listed. And now, as we've said previously, there may be far more. This may just be an idea of what they are. There's a lot of different ways to evaluate all that, and we're not going to split hairs over those kinds of things. But we're going to take that list of gifts, and we're just going to kind of walk through them. If you walk away from here feeling like you got it all figured out, then you're doing better than most of us. The reality is, we're only going to be able to just touch the surface on these things. But it's important for us to kind of get a feel for an understanding for the idea of what the spiritual gifts are and how they might look in our world. As with much of the discussion we've had so far, we're going to see that there are places of disagreement. As we talk about what they are and what that means and what those words mean, there are going to be some of you who come from different backgrounds than others, and some of you are going to take the approach that I take, some of you are going to think that I don't go far enough, and some of you are going to think that I go too far. Those are things that you need to deal with before the Lord, and I'm going to try and present to the best of my ability a foundational understanding that reflects what I have been taught, what I've come to believe, what I believe is in line with the teaching of the Christian Missionary Alliance, and I don't think that we stand alone, and that's where we're going to come to. But also remember that the important aspect that is the same for all of us is the calling to be filled with the Holy Spirit continually over and over again. You see, we want to fight about this gift or that gift and how you use this gift or that gift and whether you can use this gift or that gift. That's what we tend to want to focus on. The reality is, we're called to be continually being filled with the Holy Spirit, because it's not something that the Holy Spirit hands to us to take and use. Spiritual gifts are what the Holy Spirit does through us by His power, as we are the vessels that He's called, and they can only be used appropriately because the Holy Spirit does that through us. And as we are, we'll see the fruit of the Holy Spirit grow in us when we see the filling of the Holy Spirit constantly upon us. And I would much rather have people look at me and see the fruit of the Spirit than to have to worry about the gifts that the Holy Spirit may bring. Because when people see in us love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and gentleness and long-suffering, then people will see an image of Jesus Christ in us, regardless of how it manifests itself back out. This is the case. This is what we desire. If we do this, the Holy Spirit will be able to use us supernaturally. And He will manifest His spiritual gifts in us and through us. And it'll not be for our own glory, and it'll not be for our own benefit, but it'll be for His glory, and it'll be for the edification of the body. And it's the purpose of the gifts. And so, look with me at the list. What I'm going to do is I'm going to break the list of gifts down into three categories. There's a lot of different ways you can do this, and different people do it in different ways, and that's all fine. I looked at potentially taking one list in Romans and another list in Corinthians, but that just gets too cumbersome because there's overlaps and those kinds of things. And so what I'm going to do over the this week and next week is I'm going to take the gifts and I'm going to break them into three categories, and we're going to address each category individually. You can choose different categories, it doesn't matter. There's nothing holy or sacred about the categories that I choose. It just makes sense for me to do it this way, and so that's what I've done. The first category that we're going to deal with, and we'll deal with today, is the category of the speaking gifts. Gifts that require some type of speaking and conveying the word to others. Next week we will pick up and we will speak about the next category, which are the serving gifts. And then on our last one, we will use or speak about what I call the signifying gifts. All right, so today, speaking gifts, and then serving gifts, and then signifying gifts. So that's what we'll do. So let's start right out with the speaking gifts. When you read in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 28 and 29, you see the first gift listed is the gift of apostle. It's also in Ephesians 4:11. And this is one of those controversial areas. This is one of those places that different people have different viewpoints. What does it mean to have the gift of apostleship? Now, there are many today who would start right out of the beginning and say the gift of apostleship no longer exists. It was only for the New Testament church at the beginning. And there's a sense that that is correct. There's a sense that it's correct. That there were a group of apostles, namely 12, that met certain criteria, and if you didn't meet those criteria, you couldn't be in that group of apostles. It's a restricted use, referring to the original 12. Some would offer it also to Paul, and then of course we have the great debate about Matthias, the one who was appointed later to replace Judas. Who wasn't Paul, but so there's 12 of them, maybe 13, depending on whether you count Judas and Matthias, and it could be up to 15 if you include everybody. But it's a restricted use, and this is a true restricted use. There is a place that the Bible is very clear that there were a select group, and they met certain criteria. Let me tell you what they were. Qualifications included. Tell me if any of you meet this qualification. You had to be with Jesus from the beginning. Acts chapter 1 verses 21 and 22 say that the apostles had to be with Jesus from the beginning of his ministry. Okay, so that pretty much eliminates all of us and anyone else who's alive today. You had to be personally called by Christ. We're not talking about some personal calling in a dream or a vision, but Jesus actually spoke to you. Paul qualifies because if you remember on his way to Damascus, Jesus literally spoke out of heaven and said, I call you. We get that also, it tells us in Mark chapter 3 verse 14, John chapter 20 verse 21, it gives us this qualification. You also had to witness live with your own eyes firsthand the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Again, Acts chapter 1 verse 22. Your purpose was to lay the doctrinal foundation of the church. That's what it tells us in John chapter 14, 26 and John chapter 16, 13. So you had to be one of the people who laid the doctrinal foundation for the church. In other words, you probably had to write at least part of the New Testament. Not necessarily, but you had to have that kind of authority. You laid the structural foundation of the church according to Ephesians 2:20. Okay, now, if you've not noticed, you can't have not been there when the New Testament church started and meet these qualifications. They also had the power to work miracles according to the book of Acts, and it's throughout the book of Acts. Oh, and by the way, these 12, whoever they may be, depending on where you put Paul and Matthias and all that, these 12 will sit on the 12 thrones in heaven. Obviously, there can only be 12 if there's only 12 thrones. And your names will be inscribed on the 12 foundations of the New Jerusalem, according to Luke chapter 22, verses 29 and 30, and Revelation 21, 14. Okay, so what I've just said to you, if you catch this, is there were a group of 12 men who were appointed by Jesus to be the apostles. And there's not room for 13 or 14 or 15, there's 12. There will not be more of these people. And they had a specific goal, job, responsibility given to them by Christ, and they will receive a special reward in heaven, that of being sitting on the thrones and their names inscribed upon the foundations of the New Jerusalem because of that calling. None of us are those people. None of us are those people. Now, having said that, I believe that there is a broader context of people who have the spiritual gift of apostleship today. And you say, well, Pastor, how can that be? Because you just told us this. Well, if you look at Acts chapter 14, verses 4 and 14, you find that there's another man who is not part of the 12. His name was Barnabas. And he's called an apostle. We find that James, the brother of Jesus, he was not one of the original 12, yet it tells us in Galatians 1:19 that he was called an apostle. Silas and Timothy are both listed in 1 Thessalonians 1:1 and 2:6 as apostles. Paul claims to be an apostle, yet never says that he's one of the original 12. Some of us want to make him one of those original 12, and yet Paul never claimed to be one of the original 12. He just claimed to be an apostle. And he honored the 12, including Matthias, the one who was elected, if you will, called to replace Judas. And by the way, nowhere in the New Testament is the calling of Matthias to replace Judas ever refuted or said it was wrong or shouldn't have happened or that Matthias doesn't qualify. So, at very least, there's 13 by our own mindset, and yet God makes it very clear there were 12 of the originals, there'll never be any more, and yet there are a number of other people throughout the New Testament who are called apostles. So what's the role of this gift? If you're an apostle, if you have the gift of apostleship, what is your role? What is your place in the world? Well, there's some very clear things that come out. When we look at the lives of these that are mentioned as apostles later on, and we look at the structures that are there in the gifts, one of the key places that we see apostles would be in our missionaries. Paul was a missionary. Barnabas was a missionary. These men were missionaries. They weren't just missionaries who were evangelists who went out to save people, but they were missionaries who went out and planted churches. So apostles have a particular role in being missionaries and planting churches. Now you can see how that would connect back to the original 12. Because what does a missionary church planter do? Well, they go into cultures and they develop structurally new churches, both cross-culturally and locally. And missionaries, the word missionary comes from the Latin word to send. To send. The word missionary comes from the Latin word to send. Well, isn't that amazing that the word apostle comes from the Greek word, which means to send. The gift usually accompanies other gifts because it's really hard, and I can tell you from experience, it's really hard to plant churches and be a missionary if you don't have some other gifts to go along with it. Gifts that are very common with apostles would be the gift of evangelism, might be the gift of pastor-teacher to enable the person to fulfill the requirements of the ministry. You can't just go out and say, I'm going to put a structure together and plant a church. You have to be somebody who can not only put the structures together and build the foundational things of a local congregation, but you need to be able to lead people to Christ. You need to be able to draw them in. You need to be able to pastor them and teach them along the way. Apostleship. Yes, a limited use that refers to 12. There'll never be more of those. But apostles yet today, people who do a very specific work to lay the foundations and the structures of church bodies throughout the world. Number two, prophecy. Prophecy. Prophecy is one of the couple of things that are listed in all of the great passages that refer to spiritual gifts. So you'll find it in Romans chapter 12, verse 6. You'll find it in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 10. You'll find it in 1 Corinthians 12, 28, 1 Corinthians 12, 29, Ephesians 4, 11. Prophecy is one of those areas that, again, we struggle with. There are those who believe that we have stifled the prophetic word of the Holy Spirit in our churches today, and we no longer have prophets. Not because we shouldn't, but because we have stifled the Holy Spirit. On the other end of the spectrum, we have those who believe the gift of prophecy was only for a certain period of time. Now that we have the entirety of the Word of God, we no longer need prophets. In both cases, I think that sometimes we have exceeded what God has said and what God expects because it's what makes us feel comfortable. The word prophet means to foretell. That means that you are a spokesman for God. A prophet is a spokesman for God. In the Old Testament, it included talking about things that had happened in the past, things that were happening in the present, and also future events. A prophet in the Old Testament told about what was going to happen. They told about things like the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. They told about specific world events that had not played out yet. So they were, in essence, foretelling the future. And God would give them dreams and visions and sometimes verbal communications so they knew specifically what God was telling them to do. But a prophet spoke only that which was given to them by God. Prophets would instruct and they would warn and they would exhort and they would promise and they would rebuke, but only what God says. Only what God gave them to give. You go through the Old Testament, it's filled with prophets. A bunch of the books in the Old Testament are written by prophets and their prophetic word. Previous to the final canon of the Bible, God gave new revelation. When the New Testament didn't exist yet, God was still in the business of giving new revelation. He was still talking about things that were yet to come. The book of Revelation is predominantly about stuff that has still yet not occurred. Now we do have the canon of the New Testament. You see, the primary source of the Bible, as we have it, came from prophets or people with the gift of prophecy. God breathed His word into those who wrote Scripture under His inspiration. You can't call that any less than prophecy. God spoke into people that they could write what He had to say, they could teach what God was teaching. It's true of the Old Testament, and it's true of the New Testament. God has told us in His Word that there is no new revelation. The canon is complete. There won't be a third testament, unlike what some people teach today. There won't be additional. This is it. You have it. We have all that we need to live according to God's plan for our lives. When we begin to add to this, we get more distortion and more conflict. So when somebody comes to you and says, God has told me to write another testament to add to what's in Scripture, that there's something more there, you can look at them and go, false prophet. That's not true. So what is prophecy? If it's not new revelation, see, that's where we get hung up. We get hung up in prophecy has to be foretelling the future. New revelation. Well, if it's not that, then what is it? Prophecy is still all that it always previously was without new revelation, without new scripture, without new text. It is continuing to foretell what God has to say. It's instructive and it's warning and it's exhortation and it's promises and it's rebuke. The truth comes from God through various forms, but the truth is verifiable through Scripture. The difference between Old Testament prophecy and even New Testament prophecy and what we see in the form of prophecy today is sometimes prophecy was given in the Old Testament, which we didn't have in written form. And we can only verify by God's revelation to us. The New Testament was given prophetically, and we didn't have anything to verify it with except for God's revelation to us. But now, with the completion of Scripture, prophecy will not contradict Scripture, and it will be verifiable in its content through Scripture. That's the difference. It includes making Scripture relevant to a current specific context. It's a clearer understanding or an amplification of already given truth. Not a contradiction, not something that's more, not something that's less, but it's an amplification, an understanding, a clarification, so that it becomes very applicable to our lives. It's understanding what God has to say in His Word and applying it to situations at hand. You see, the Bible doesn't tell us about every situation that we'll ever be in. It doesn't tell us that we're going to go to work tomorrow and experience such and such. The Bible doesn't tell us that, but it does give us the principles to deal with whatever that such and such is. And the word of prophecy is that opportunity for us to have an expansion of how the Scriptures apply to those specific situations that are coming up in our life. For someone to see demonic oppression in a specific area upon a specific person is taking the truth of Ephesians 6:12 and following that talks about we wrestle not against flesh and blood but against the powers and the principalities of this dark world. And it allows us to see that specifically in action and be able to look at a situation or a person or a place or whatever the case may be and go, this is God's application. This is it truly happening right here. This is a wrestling match that's going on not between somebody who's sick, but between somebody who's wrestling with demonic forces and being able to understand the difference and being able to help us see the difference. Somebody with the prophetic gift can help us see the truth of the Scripture in practical application to our lives. Does that make sense? Are you with me? Do you get it? Am I just mumbling? You're all there? Okay. You see the difference? It's not about, well, you know, in 62 days, you know, such and such is going to happen. That's not what prophecy is about today. As a matter of fact, that's never what prophecy was about. Oh yeah, we see signs of people who said you're going to have famine for 7 years and so forth, but why? So that they could go, look at me, I told you what was going to happen? No, so that they could say, now this is what God is telling you to do about it. And it was all about pointing people to Christ. But the prophetic word for today allows us to see how the Scriptures, who give us all that we need to live our lives appropriately today, apply those concepts, those truths, in an applicable way to the current situations that we walk in day by day. And if somebody says something and it's contrary to Scripture, I'll give you an example. A person came to me one time and said, I believe that God has called me to divorce my spouse. You don't have to be a prophet to say, no, he didn't. Because that's contrary to Scripture. There might be an allowance for that depending on circumstances, but God didn't call you to that. God calls you to reconciliation. Right? So people who come and say, well, God told me, and they tell you something contrary to Scripture, that's not real, it's not true, and it's not prophetic. But God does come and say, you know, I see in this situation that there's something deeper. There's something more there. Not contrary to Scripture, but we can look at Scripture and see the support for that. It can get complicated sometimes, but it's still real. We need to make sure that we measure this and not eliminate it, but see how it fits. And by the way, you're going to find out as we go forward, especially when we get to 1 Corinthians chapter 14, that not only does Paul say this gift is not gone, but he says that it is the most important gift. And by the way, one of the most common gifts given. We're afraid of it because we're afraid that someone's going to tell us the future and that's evil. But that's not what it's all about. Number three, evangelism. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. Evangelism is about spreading the gospel message. Some people have the gift of evangelism. All of us are required to spread the gospel message. Did you know that? You don't have to have the gift of evangelism. You're required. Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20, the Great Commission. All of us are called to go into the world and present the gospel. We're all called to tell people about Jesus and His love. We're all called to explain to people what it means to be saved. Every single one of us has that responsibility. And all of us have available to us power from the Holy Spirit to do so. Acts 1:8, all power. We all have the power of the Holy Spirit to do the work of evangelism, every single one of us. But the gift of evangelism is supernatural ability that goes beyond. The definition of evangelism, the gift of proclaiming the good news of salvation effectively so that people respond to the claims of Christ in conversion and in discipleship. There's a number of elements in there that I want to point out. I like this definition because it really points out what is significant in the gift of evangelism apart from all of us evangelizing. Let me just say this. I've had the opportunity to share my faith with lots of people, and a few of them have come to Christ. Some of you have had your opportunities to share your faith with a number of people. Some of you have maybe never seen anyone come to Christ, despite all the sharing that you did. God is not going to get you to heaven and go, well, you didn't share your faith well enough, good enough, appropriately enough, and that's why no one came to Christ. You see, all of us are called to share our faith. None of us have the ability to make somebody a Christian. We're not judged for how many people came to Christ. We're judged for whether we obeyed Christ as He called us to share. That's what we'll be rewarded for. That's what we'll look at. So if you say, my experience has been less than wonderful, just keep at it because you're here to please God and not to please man. And He says, what pleased me is you tell people. It's up to the Holy Spirit to change a heart and to draw people to Him. And none of us can do that. But there are those who have a special gifting in the area of evangelism. The gift of evangelism, the gift of proclaiming the good news of salvation effectively so that people respond to the claims of Christ in conversion and in discipleship. You see, it includes proclamation. There must be words as well as works. Those of you who think that evangelism is just living your life out right before other people, that is not evangelism. We had this wonderful trend about 20 years ago in the church that we're going to do lifestyle evangelism and people are going to get saved. And now 20 years later, guess what? People didn't get saved. Some did, but not because of the lifestyle. Do we need the right lifestyle? You betcha we do, because if not, the words that we say have no meaning. If I tell you about Jesus and His love and His forgiveness and I refuse to forgive, then my lifestyle doesn't match my words and it will push people away. So we need to live the lifestyle of Christ. But then we need to explain to people what that means. I remember being at a conference, as a matter of fact, it was right after I became a pastor in the Christian Missionary Alliance, back in the old days when I was going through that. We had this really cool thing that we got to do, and when you became licensed for the first time, and we still do this, when you become licensed in the Christian Missionary Alliance, we send you away to a licensing conference, and we kind of orient you to being a pastor in the Christian Missionary Alliance. You know, Pastor Mike got to do that a few years ago, and they sent him down to, you know, some camp down Cambridge area or whatever, and he got to spend a few days away. It was really nice and cool. When I did that, we had more money, and so we all went to Colorado Springs because that's where the national office is, and they brought in, you know, these renowned Christian Missionary Alliance pastors from all over the country, and they spoke to us and addressed us, and we went through the national headquarters, and we met with the president, and, you know, we did all that kind of stuff. You know, that's the benefit of being older. The thing that was amazing about that time, I remember we stayed at a college campus while we were there. And we stayed in the dorms for the, I don't know, 5 or 6 days that we were out there. And there were students, it was during the summer, but there were still students in the dorm. And so every night there would be this opportunity where you would be interacting with some of the students that were staying in the dorms. And I remember walking down past the laundry room on the way to to the lobby one night just to see what was going on. And in the laundry room were two people. One was a student and one was one of the other new pastors that were there. And they were having dialogue, and it was really kind of interesting. As I listened to the dialogue, I kind of stood around the corner and listened to what was going on, because I'm not a great evangelist, and I thought, well, every opportunity I get to hear what somebody else does will help me. And I listened for a few minutes, and basically what I kept hearing was this pastor shake his finger in the face of this guy and say, "You're going to hell, you're lost, you're going to hell, you got to find Jesus, you're going to hell." And he thought, "I'm doing this wonderful thing because I'm evangelizing." And I thought, this is terrible. This is horrible. And finally, I couldn't take it anymore, and I walked in. "Hey, what's going on?" Like I didn't know what was going on. And this other pastor just kept shaking his finger, and he kept going on. And after a couple more minutes of it, I just couldn't hardly stand it anymore. And after I suppressed the urge to punch the guy in the face, I looked at the student who was looking for a way to get past him out the door. You know, it was like the linebacker was blocking the door and telling him what he had to have. And the student, you know, was just like almost overcome with, "Man, these people are idiots." You just see it in his face, and he wanted to get out. And I looked at this young person. I said, "Can I ask you a question?" He said, "Yeah, anything." I said, "Do you know anything about Jesus?" And he said, "Well, I know that, you know, he was this great guy that lived, you know, a long time ago, and Christians believe that he's someone important." And I said, "Would you be interested in knowing anything more about Jesus?" He said, "Well, I don't know." And I said, "Well, I'll tell you what I want you to do." I said, "If you're willing," I said, "you don't have to do it now. You do it whenever it's comfortable for you. But it may be years from now, and you think back on this conversation." I said, "Here's what I would like you to do. I would like you just to take your Bible. If you need one, I'll get you one." "No, I got a Bible." I said, "Okay. Look in the index in the front or in the table of contents. Find the book of John. And I would challenge you just to read the book of John. Because despite what you're hearing here tonight and despite what you're seeing around you, the book of John really tells us a little bit about who Jesus really was." I said, "Now, it's going to say some really weird things, you know, like, you know, I'm light and I'm the Word and the Word became flesh and some of that kind of stuff. It's a little confusing sometimes, but if you just go in and you say, 'God, if you're real and you want me to understand something, help me understand this. And let me give you my name and number. And if you want to call me, if you have questions, or if you want to see me in the next few days while I'm around here, you feel free to do that. Would you be willing to do that?'" And he took my name and number and he said, "Well, we'll see." And he walked out. And I thought, I wonder what that man's going to remember. I wonder what's going to happen to that person. See, the other guy was so interested in being an evangelist that he was willing to push somebody away from Christ to further what he thought was right. And the reality was, 2 minutes into the conversation, it became very apparent that this person was hostile to the environment that he was in. He may not have been hostile to Christ when he walked in, but he sure was by the time he left. But he was hostile to the environment. You see, evangelist has the ability to proclaim the truth, to say what's true, but to do it in a way that God would have him to do it. Proclaiming the truth effectively. It's not effective to pound your Bible, to point your finger, and to tell somebody that they're dying and going to hell. What's effective is to make a connection with the individual and share the truth. Now, Billy Graham can stand up in a pulpit and he can say some of those things. But why is it effective for him? Because the people that he's saying it to chose to come there to hear that. Billy Graham doesn't trap somebody in the room and say, this is what I'm going to force you to hear. I'm going to offer this. If you want to come and listen, come and listen. If you don't come. Effective proclamation. It's good news. I want to tell you something. That guy in that laundry room, he didn't hear any good news. The gospel is the good news of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ came to save us from our sins and to forgive us and to give us eternal life. Does it require us to admit that we have sin in our lives and to deal with that? Absolutely. But the good news is Jesus provided a way to do that. Jesus didn't come to beat you up over the head and tell you how bad you are and how you're going to hell. He came to provide good news. This person forgot that the gospel is the good news. It's intellectual and emotional, and it's faith-based on evidence, but it's good news. And when good news is presented effectively, it will lead people towards Christ and towards conversion. Those who have the spiritual gift of evangelism find that far more of the people they communicate with come to Christ than the average person. They don't win every time. It's not even about winning or losing. We've already won when we present the gospel. But not everyone comes to Christ. The evangelist will win more than most, and most encounters will leave the person thinking. Even if they don't accept, they'll be thinking about what's been shared with them. It will lead them to thoughtfully determine to make a response. It might be a no response. Did you know that there were people that came to Christ that he didn't lead to him? Most notable, the rich young ruler. Oh, I've fulfilled the law. I've done everything. What do I need to do to get to heaven? Jesus said, sell all your possessions and follow me. And he hung his head and he walked away and said, no, thank you. So even Jesus, who was the perfect evangelist, didn't win everyone. But he cut to the core of the issue. Gift of evangelism. Number four, gift of shepherding. Gift of shepherding. You see it as the word pastor, as shepherd. It's in Ephesians 4:11. A pastor or a shepherd is a guide. Psalm 23 is all about shepherds. Right? 23rd Psalm, it's about shepherds. It's about what does a shepherd do? What does a pastor do? By the way, not everybody who is a preacher is a pastor. Did you know that? Some of us preachers struggle with the gift of pastoring. It's not in the top of my list set, I'm sorry, but that's the way that God created me. Some of the things that pastors do, some of them are hard. Some of them come naturally. A pastor feeds the flock in the Word of God. That one's not so hard for me. Sharing the truth, feeding the flock. What does a shepherd do with the sheep? He feeds them. He makes sure that they're led to the pasture so that they can get the food. The pastor guards the flock. He protects them from the attacks of the wolves. He protects them from the things that may come that would infringe upon them. He leads them. He protects them. By the way, there are people who are not pastors who have the ability to do that. And there are people who are pastors who maybe aren't so good at some of those things. I've met some pastors that lead people in the Word of God really well, but boy, when it comes to protection, they have trouble protecting themselves, let alone someone else. I know people who can stand tall and protect people no matter what comes their way, but when it comes to leading them in the Word of God, you kind of go, maybe, maybe not. But I know plenty of people, and those who have been through elder training in this church, and those who have gone through that and come onto our elder boards, have been taught very clearly that you have to do those two things if you're an elder in this church. You have to learn the Word of God and be prepared to share that Word, the truth of that Word. You have to recognize that Word. Doesn't mean you have to preach, not necessarily. Do you have to be a teacher somewhere? Not necessarily. But you're going to have opportunities to interact with people, and you need to be a spiritual leader based on the Word of God and be able to present the truth and present it clearly. But you also need to protect the flock. When the attacks come, if somebody would ever stand up in this pulpit, and I've told my elders, if you don't do this, I'll ask you to step down. If somebody steps up in this pulpit, whether it's me or Pastor Mike or anyone else, and starts to say stuff that's contrary to Scripture, if the elders don't stand up and put a stop to it, then they'll be asked to resign. We have to protect the flock. We have to. But it's not just one or two gifted men. By the way, women can have the pastoral gift. In our denomination, we don't necessarily allow them to be pastors in the sense of standing up in the pulpit and preaching and leading, but there's plenty of other leadership roles that they can have, and they still need that same ability to be able to teach the Word and understand the truth of the Word of God and be able to protect the flock that's there. If you're a woman teaching a children's Sunday school class, those kids need to hear the true Word of God, not some variation of it, and they need to be protected from people who would do something else. That's just as valid, just as important. Number five, teaching. We see that in Romans 12, 7 and 8. We see it in 1 Corinthians 12, 28. We see it in Ephesians 4, 11. Teaching is the ability to explain clearly and apply correctly the Word of God. When we talk about teaching, there's plenty of people who have a talent to teach. They may or may not have the spiritual gift of teaching. What's the big difference? The big difference is those who have the spiritual gift of teaching, it's applied specifically to the Word of God. The spiritual gift of teaching is about the ability to explain clearly and apply correctly the Word of God. It's more than sharing data or truth. It's about imparting the truth in a way that causes action and application. And it's about the truth of God's Word. By the way, the gift of teaching is often closely connected to the gift of prophecy. Those two gifts very often will be found in the same people. Not necessarily, but quite often that is the case. Because the prophecy is about that understanding the Word to be able to apply the Word and the truth and see what's going on in the current situation. Teaching is about application of the truth of the Word of God. Those two often come close together. Next, number six, exhortation, Romans chapter 12, verse 8. The gift of exhortation. This gift is about coming alongside someone to strengthen, to assure, to console, and to encourage them. Exhorters don't tend to condone wrongdoing. They don't let wrongdoing go unchallenged or unchecked. Exhorters help the victim to see how to overcome the sin. An exhorter doesn't just come alongside you and say, it'll be okay. No, they come alongside and say, do you see the sin that's going on? Let me help you overcome the sin. Let me point you to Christ to overcome the sin. Let me help you see what the Word of God has to say. I'm going to encourage you, not to encourage you to stay in your sin, not to encourage you to ignore your sin, but in the midst of your sin, in the midst of your struggle, I'm going to encourage you that you may be able to help overcome the sin. The gift is often used in a one-on-one counseling kind of situation. Exhorters tend to be good counselors. They tend to be able to sit with somebody one-on-one and let them pour themselves out and explain what they're dealing with and their struggles and then help them work through that. It may be used in writing, as in the New Testament epistles. Paul exhorts us all the time in all of his writings. He'll write a letter. You need help in this area. You're struggling in this area. Here's the help that I have to offer. And it often occurs over time and deals with specific issues. Exhortation is not one time walking into a situation and say, I encourage you, brother, and walking away. Those with the gift of exhortation tend to engage with people who are struggling and stay engaged while that process takes place. Exhortation. The last two I'm going to bundle together. They're bundled together in a number of places. You find them in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 8, and they're the gifts of knowledge and wisdom. Knowledge and wisdom. Knowledge and wisdom are different, two separate things, but they're very closely related. Knowledge is about information, but wisdom is about the right use of the information to achieve an end. Knowledge is the power to search and to systemize and to summarize the teachings of the Word of God. To be able to take the Word of God and put it together in a way that makes sense and people can understand and it's systematized and it's knowledgeable, it's informative, and it brings illumination to God's Word. It emphasizes truth over experience. It's often overlooked in Christianity today because we like experience. We want to know how we feel. Oh, that happened to me. And sometimes we're willing to ignore knowledge and say that what the Bible says isn't near as important. As long as we had a good experience, then it must be okay. But that's never acceptable. Experience has to be measured with truth. It was a big issue for the Corinthian church, who wanted the experience of speaking in tongues and ignored the truth of what the Word said about why that gift even existed and what it was supposed to be used for. Heard the story one day, I'll illustrate it for you. A young man was traveling across the ocean on a ship after having completed 4 years of study abroad. And as they were traveling, he was reviewing all of the notes and all of the things that he'd learned over those 4 years, and he's sitting on the deck and he's reading his stuff and he's going through it and he's kind of contemplating all that he'd learned and how wonderful an experience it was. And all of a sudden a big wave came and it tossed the ship. And in tossing the ship, the man was thrown from his chair and he was fine, but his notes blew overboard and blew out to sea. And he lost it all. And he arrived back in his home port, and upon arriving, he went immediately to the ticket counter, and he says, I need to buy a passage back overseas. And the man said, well, why? You just arrived. And he said, yes, but my notes were blown overboard. I need to go back for 4 more years so I can learn the information again. That'll sink in a few minutes. You'll get that. Knowledge is about assimilating information, and specifically about the Word of God, understanding what it says. By the way, if you ever achieve full knowledge, then we need to know, because Jesus has not returned yet. I don't know how many times I've read through the book of the Bible. I've read it through in its entirety. I've read it through pieces and parts at a time, as most of us have done. And every time there's something new, there's something that I didn't get before. Knowledge is important. We need to understand what the Word of God says. We need to make it part of our lives. But knowledge without wisdom lacks. And wisdom is about application. It's about using knowledge to solve problems and to deal with issues and choosing rightly in situations. It's used in the defense of the truth, and it helps us answer unbelievers' arguments. You know, that guy that was in that laundry room at that university had plenty of knowledge, but he had absolutely no wisdom. He could tell you what the Bible said, and he picked out the parts that said what he wants, but in the situation he was in, he couldn't recognize the proper use of the knowledge. So wisdom is about the application. It helps us solve dilemmas. It's useful in daily life. Knowledge and wisdom must be together. For wisdom without knowledge leads us astray into all kinds of things. Wisdom is of no value without knowledge. But likewise, knowledge without practical wisdom is futility. I've dealt with so many people who have studied the Bible their whole lives. And you sit down across the table with them and you talk to them, and they know what the Bible says about everything, and you're amazed, and they quote scripture after scripture after scripture, and they tell you all that the Bible says. And then you say something like, well, tell me what you did for Christ recently. And they, huh? Tell me about the last person you shared your faith with. Who? What? It's like they get in the cone of silence, and they sit there reading the Bible, and they know everything it says, and it's like, but aren't you going to use it? Aren't you going to do something with all that knowledge? Huh? They look at you like you're cross-eyed. When we have knowledge of God's Word and the correct wisdom to use it, we become effective. When this is provided by the Holy Spirit, it changes the face of Christianity to a far purer and more effective form. The speaking gifts. Some of you are looking at your own lives and you're going, well, I can see how I might have some of that, or maybe I have that, or maybe I'm able to use that, or maybe I've had experience in that area. Some of you are going, never thought about that before. Don't know where that fits. Folks, it's not a challenge to say that every one of you has to fit into that list somewhere. Some of you do and some of you don't. You'll fit in somewhere before we're done. And if you can't figure that one out, then we need to have a talk, because God said that everybody receives at least one gift when they come to know Christ. But nobody receives them all. Those are the speaking gifts. Those are the ones that require us to speak, to communicate, to share with others. Why? To glorify God and to edify the body. All those gifts are not about condemning others, putting others down. They're about building others up and helping others to become all that God has called them to be. Find your gift today. Pray about it. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word in this list. And I know, Father, sometimes we want to be able to walk away and go, now I feel better because now I have this, or I know that, or I can change this in my life, or I can't. Lord, I know that some people here today go, that's interesting. And I shared with them a bunch of knowledge. And Lord, we need your Holy Spirit to bring the wisdom to go with that. We need those with the gift of exhortation to come along. We need the pastors and the teachers to step up, and the teachers to do what they're called to do, and the shepherds to do their job, and the apostles to do what they're going to do, and the prophets to jump in. And Lord, all of those gifts all need to work together for the body to be complete. You see, it's not about one gift or another. Lord, we need to be about being the body together. All of us doing the part that you've given us to do. None of us doing it by our own power. All of us doing that which only you can empower us to do. So Lord, would you continue to show us? Would you continue to lead us? Lord, would you overpower us with your Holy Spirit and give us the right thoughts and desires that we can do what you've called us to? We pray it in Jesus' powerful name. Amen.